Hello everyone, welcome back to another session of construction management. And now at last we are going to discuss about project scheduling and resource leveling. All right, so let us begin with what we are going to learn in this session. So here are the contents of the session. We are going to start with introduction, then objects of resource planning and methods of resource allocation. So let us begin with the introduction. So students, as you know that to do any construction work, we require four kind of resources: man, money, material and machinery. And when we were doing the analysis by CPM or PERT method, our only focus was on time. We were only using the time analysis, that in what time a project will be completed, or even we used to find the float, but that too was on based on only on time constraint. But to perform a particular activity, we required certain resources. So in real time situation, it may happen that number of resources are very limited with us. So in certain situation, we need to change our planning. For an example, to perform an activity, we have a restricted material or restricted skilled labor or unskilled labor. Then to perform a certain activity, we have limited time available or the limited equipment available to perform that part. Even the owner or the contractor will tell you that we have lack of fund or limited fund to perform this. So there is always limitations or constraints are on, pardon me, based on resources. So that is the problem which we are going to discuss in the entire lecture series of project scheduling and resource leveling. Now let us see the objects of resource planning. So as we have discussed in the earlier slide, that at the time of preparing network, we were thinking that to perform this activity, number of resources which are required will be available in ample of amount to perform this activity. But in the real-time scenario, it may not be the truth. It may happen that you fall short in case of resources. And if you are falling short in the case of resources, that will cause a delay in your project. And the delay in your project will cost you, will have something extra cost. That is the problem which I am trying to focus on, which I am trying to have a light on. So I hope you are getting my point by learning this resource planning, objects of resource planning. So moving forward, hence the planning of the resources should be done in such manner so that there should not be increase and decrease in the demand of the resources. As the engagement of any labor, skilled labor, is difficult, similarly, layoff of a labor suddenly is also difficult. So being a planner, our end objective is to complete the project within the limited resources but within the time. And to do so, sometimes we need to fluctuate the earliest start time or the latest finish time of the activities. Or even it may happen that we need to postpone certain activities from being executed. So that is the case. Moving ahead in the session, now as we have discussed that as a being a planner, either we should fluctuate the early start time or the latest finish time of the critical activity, or we could decide that we will postpone the execution of certain activities. Now while taking these decisions, we need to consider the following points. The first is, those activities who has minimum time should be started and completed first. Second, the activity which has maximum completion time should be postponed. And the last point is, the activity which has the maximum float available with the activity should be chosen for postponing the first. It may happen that when we are doing the resource planning, a number of activities will have float. So out of that number of activity, that activity should be postponed first, who has the maximum float value. So these are the things which we need to keep in mind while doing the resource plan. Now let us see what are the methods of resource planning, or we can say resource allocation. Let us see that. So here are the methods for the resource planning. The first is resource smoothing and the second is resource leveling. There are two methods by which you can have the resource planning or resource allocation. So let us begin with the learnings of resource smoothing. So students, let me tell you, the first point of the method resource smoothing is it is resorted or done when there is constraint when you are not allowed to change the total duration of the project. The resource smoothing is applied in such a way that the total project duration does not get affected. That is the very first point. That is the logic of the method, that whatever resource you are applying to do the construction, you are not allowed to change the total number of days. For an example, if there is a planning, activity wise planning is saying that the project should be completed within 30 days, then you need to allocate the resource and plan the resource in such a way that it should completed in 30 days. So first, the periods of minimum resource requirements are located, and then the activities are being fluctuated or shifted based on their float. So the activities who are having maximum float are shifted in the network diagram, and then the requirement of the resource is being smoothed out. So that is being known as resource smoothing. Now let us see the step-by-step process of resource smoothing. So the first point is list of resources required for the activities is being carried out, and the important activities are for the project has been identified. That is the first point, that what kind of resources you require, that you need to identify. Moving forward with the next step. Now in the second step, resource profiles are prepared from the resource aggregation, and the cumulative resource requirement for each unit has been prepared using histogram, or you can say that the histogram is being prepared for the cumulative resource requirement. That is your second step, that you need to prepare the histogram. Now what is histogram, we'll see in the numerical. Moving forward with the third step, that is now the time periods of peak and low demands are identified, and then the turf or the peak demand are being lowered down. When you prepare a histogram is a resource requirement graph. When you prepare that, so there at certain point there are high resource requirement, and certain point there is low resource requirement. So we need to smooth out. We are going to smooth that. Alright. So moving forward with the next step, that is, so now here comes the main point. See, we need to smooth out the resources as maximum as possible. I'm not saying that in every case you will be smoothing out all the resources in the project. That is next to impossible, because every project is unique. Every project has different resource requirements. So you cannot do the resource smoothing accurately. Our aim is to maximum try to lower down the peak and to fill the turfs. That is our point. So now, using float of non-critical activity and fluctuating the start time and the finish time, we can perform the resource smoothing. So I hope we are clear about step-by-step process of resource smoothing. Now let us understand a numerical for resource smoothing. So here is the question, students. As you can see in the slide, that a table is given for a construction project having activity, duration and manpower requirement. Now we need to determine, or we need to prepare a project schedule which will minimize the peak requirements. And then to minimize the peak requirement, we need to smooth out the resources. Alright? So that is the question. So students, let me sum up the matter for you that we need to allocate what activity requires what total amount of resources. Then also we need to determine the float. So to prepare the float, the very first point is to draw the network. So here, as you can see, activity name or the activities are directly given the based on event type. 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 2, 4, 2, 5, such like. So we can directly prepare the network. So let us begin with the activity which are starting from 1. So 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 4. Let us draw that. So here is the network representation of 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4. Then the next wall, 2, 4, 2, 5. Let us draw that. So here is the graphical representation of 2, 4, 2, 5. Now students, as you can see, I am writing the activity name on above the arrow and duration on below the arrow. Again, activity name on above the arrow, activity duration below the arrow. But here, as we are discussing for resource smoothing, I have written number of resource required in bracket along with the activity name. So as you can see, A bracket 7, that is your activity and number of resource required. Now let us finish the remaining part of the network. So here, as you can see, I have finished the remaining part of the network based on the given data. Now students, our focus is to find out the float. Once I have found out the float, then and only then I can fluctuate them. Without them I can do nothing. So our next step is to find out the float. And to find out the float, we need to perform what we need to perform. Recall, forward and backward analysis. So let us start forward and backward analysis. Alright, so here is the forward analysis. We are starting with point number 1. That is, above that we need to write 0. Now from 1 to 2 we have 0 plus 8, 8. For 1 to 3 we have 0 plus 6, 6. But now for point number 4 or for event number 4, we have two options. Either I can go from 1 to 4, either I can go from 2 to 4. So if I go from 1 to 4, 0 plus 8, 8. But if I go from 2 to 4, then 8 plus 12, 20. So maximum value, 20. Then for 5. For 5, again there are two options, 2 to 5, 3 to 5. So if I go from 2 to 5, 8 plus 4, 12. And if I go from 3 to 5, 6 plus 4, 10. So again maximum is 12. And for point number 6, there are two ways, 12 plus 10 and 20 plus 12. So 30 and 22, so maximum is 30. So that is my forward path analysis. Now we need to do the backward path analysis. Let us do that. So here is the backward path analysis. Starting from the point number 6, 30. So below in the triangle I have written 30. Then 6 to 5, 5 to 4, 4 to 3, 3 to 2, 3, then 2 and then 1. While doing the backward path analysis, students, you need to have the minimum values. For an example, if I talk about the event number 2, so there are two options, 3 to 2 and 5 to 2. If I go from 3 to 2, then 20 minus 8, 12. And if I go from 5 to 2, then 20 minus 4, 16. So 12 and 16, minimum value, 12. That is how we can do the backward path analysis. So we have got the total duration as 30 days or weeks, whatever the unit given in the question. Now, let us prepare the table of float. And when I say the float, I mean total float. So let us prepare the table of total float. So here is the calculation table. To calculate the total float, there is a formula LST minus EST or LFT minus EFT. But now, what is LFT, LST, EFT, EST? So EST, earliest start time, EFT, earliest finish time. LST, latest start time. LFT, latest finish time. Now, how to identify them into the network? So let us come back to the network. So here, as you can see in the network, that ahead of arrow, above the activity. Repeat with me. Ahead of arrow, above the activity. That is your EST, earliest start time. So for activity 1, 2, 0, activity 1, 3, 0, activity 1, 4, 0, 2, 4, 8. So that is how we need to prepare the earliest start time column. So here is the earliest start time. Now to find the earliest finish time, we need to add the duration in EST. EFT equals to EST plus duration. So now remaining two columns are LST and LFT. Let us come back to the network for understanding of LFT. So students, in the network, ahead of arrow upper value is EST, then below the arrow or behind the arrow, below value, end of the arrow, pardon me, end of the arrow, below value, that is your LFT. So for activity 1, 2, 8, 1, 3, 6, 1, 4, 8. So this is how we need to prepare the LFT. So here is the column of LFT. Now to find LST. So the formula to find out LST is LFT minus duration. LST equals to LFT minus duration. So that is how we have found out the EST, EFT, LST, LFT. Now we need to find out the total float. So the formula for the total float is either subtract start time or either subtract finish time. So that is how we have found out the float, and those activities who have the total float 0 are considered as critical activities. So students, up to this point we have done nothing new. This was just a pre-preparation for resource smoothing. We have not done anything. This is the sum which we were doing in the construction plan. Now our resource smoothing start. The first step is to prepare the to identify the resources and to prepare the histogram. So to identify the resources, we need to prepare, carefully hear the term, time grid diagram. We need to prepare time grid diagram. So what is time grid diagram? So time grid diagram is a diagram in which the critical path of the network is represented on the straight line. Again, time grid diagram is a diagram in which the critical path of the network is represented on the straight line, and the other activities, as mean non-critical activities, are represented above or below of the critical path. So let us draw the time grid diagram for this data. So as you can see, 1, 2, 2, 4, 4, 6 was my critical, so they are on the straight line. Now 1, 3 and 1, 4 are above and the below. Then again, 2, 5, 3, 5, 5, 6 are above or the below of the diagram. So now this dotted line are representing the float. See students, in the graph paper, one block equals to one day. I have taken one block equals to one day. So starting from 0, so 0 to 7, A7, then pardon me, A is 8, 7 is the resource requirement. So A8, then D12, G10, so as I prepared this. Now, how this dotted line come into the picture? Now, if we look at originally 1 to 4, that was the duration 8. So I've drawn 8 blocks of D. But now, as you can see, D is far away. So remaining 12, that is your float. That is your float. Again, students, I'm repeating it again that we need to draw the critical path on straight line. Now, the rest of the activity, for an example, 1 to 4. So now 1 to 4 was having duration 8. So that activity I have shown above the critical path. But now up to point 8, D should appear. But D is far away and I have completed the 8 duration. So that gap is to be filled by dotted line. So I hope we are clear about it. Now, as you can see, with the activity name, I have represented the resource requirement. So now, on the first day of the project, activity A, B and C, three of them are started. So the labor of activity A, B and C will be working on the site. So the total of A, B and C is 7 plus 9 plus 13, that is 29. So that is how we have day-to-day adding of resources. For an example, let me tell you, for come to point number 4. So now, after you reach to the event number 4, then in the project, there are only two activities running, G and H. For G, 15 labors, and for H, 5 labors. So 15 plus 5, 20. But after 2 days, dotted line has been started. That means activity H has been completed, but G is still started. So now only 15 labors are required. So that is how we have computed the labor requirement. And based on that labor requirement, below you can see I have prepared the histogram. Histogram is nothing but duration versus labor requirement graph. A simple graph of duration versus labor, but it is continuous. See, I have not prepared individual vertical bars. It is continuous graph. That is why that is known as histogram. So I hope we are clear up to this point. Now, as you can see, at initially 29 labors, then at point 10, then 17, 16, 15, unequal resources are there. So our goal is to smooth the labor at an optimum point. And to do so, now we need to focus on the activities which has the maximum flow. Let us see that. So as per the histogram, as you can see, maximum requirement of the resource is 29 and the minimum requirement is 15. And from the float table, as you can see, activity 1, 4 and 5, 6 has the maximum float of 12 days and 8 days. So initially what was happening in the time grid diagram, So in the time grid diagram, as you can see, initially activity was happening and then there was float. So I am reversing it. First 12 days float and then activity. Similarly for activity 5-6, first there was 5-6 activity, then 8 days of float. So first I will put the float and then I will perform the activity. So here is the statement which we have just discussed. Here is the statement for that. So we need to fluctuate the activity and float. Initially it was first activity, then float. Now I will do first float and then activity. Students, you can interchange the float and activity, but you cannot break the float. For an example, if there is 12 days of float, so I cannot do that, the first 6 float, then activity, then last 6 float. Either I will shift entirely 12 or 0. Alright, so I hope we are clear about it. So now let us redraw the entire time grid diagram and the histogram with effect of these two changes. So as you can see, here is the modified time grid diagram and modified histogram. So now, again, as when you add up the total resources per day, you can see almost everything is balanced on 20. So that is your resource smoothing. So I hope we are clear about the concept of resource smoothing. So this is it. That was all about in today's session. In case of any query or doubt, you can always contact me in my mail or my number. Thank you.